Welcome to C++ Weekly. In this episode, I want to talk a little bit about Threadlocal. And before I get started on that, I do want to point out that I have this issue tracker with all of my pending ideas for C++ Weekly episodes, and I try to plan things out, sometimes even multiple months in advance, depending on my conference schedule. You can come here to the GitHub, Lefticus/CPP_weekly, and you can create your own episode ideas if you want to, or you can look through the list of currently open episode ideas and comment on them, thumbs up, vote on them, that kind of thing. So this one on Threadlocal is one that I've been planning for several years now, and it has 14 thumbs up at the moment, and I've just decided to go ahead and get around to it. Before I get started, though, I do want to remind you that I am available for code reviews and on-site training, and that I have an upcoming workshop at C++ Under the Sea at the time when this episode airs. Threadlocal is weird, and it's hard in many ways, I feel like, to use it correctly. So if you've got a function, something like this, where I've got a function with some Threadlocal value in it, and this value is in a way global to each thread, and I'll explain what that means in a little bit here. So you kind of have to think of thread locals as being global to threads in the same way that static values are. So this thread local integer count is going to have its lifetime begin the first time line 3 is executed on the current thread, and its value will be initialized with 0. Then it's going to be incremented to 1, and it will return 1. So if I've got a program with just main in it, then I have one thread. I have the quote main thread. That's probably what you're going to see it listed as in your debugger. And if I call func twice here, then I'm going to see that 2 is returned from main. Now, interestingly, because this has to be treated like a static, like a global, the compiler doesn't actually know if there might be some other thread that's going to be executed in some other linked-in thing somewhere. So it gets the current value, and then it adds 2 to it, stores that value, and then returns from main. So it doesn't actually know that its starting value is 0, but it knows that it's going to return 2 more than what its starting value was. Now if I turn on execute to this code in Compiler Explorer, I should see program returned 2. And here's just a little handy print here to give us some ideas to what's actually happening along the way. So this thing, from the perspective of a single-threaded program, is effectively the same thing as a static here. And in fact, the standard explicitly states that if you have both static and thread local on the same declaration, this is the same as declaring the variable thread local. It is just a thread local object at this point. Let's get slightly more creative here, and let's try to print out the thread ID of the currently executing thread. Now, as you can see here in the always excellent cppreference.com, there is a ID member of standard thread. Now, I kind of want to be able to get the current thread, and I can see that there is this standard this thread :: get ID that returns some sort of thread ID thing, and this is a static function. And unfortunately, it seems this version of the format library that I have doesn't know how to format a thread ID. So we're going to switch over to IOStreams. As expected, we can see that this code is being executed twice from the same thread, and we can see the thread ID here. All right, let us go ahead now and create multiple threads so that you can see what is going on. And we're going to use C++ 17's jthread for this. Now, jthread is simply going to execute the function that I have passed to it with the parameters that I have passed to it, and then automatically join itself when the thread object itself goes out of scope. For the sake of this example, T1 is going to be destroyed here, which is also going to end the lifetime of that ThreadLocal object, which I will show you as well in a moment. Now, we can actually see that we're getting a little bit of interleaving of the output, a little bit of a race conditioning happening with cout here, which is rather unfortunate. The new line, specifically, is being broken across outputs. Okay, slightly cleaner. So we can see that we've got this value 1 and value 2 being executed, and we might think, hey, wait a minute, why didn't T1 get executed first? And it's because threading is just simply non-deterministic. We don't know what order the thread is actually going to be started by the operating system, executed, and then its output written to the output string. So we can see that we get this thing called once, and its value is 1 because it's starting all over from scratch. So let's do something slightly more complicated so we can track what's actually happening here. So in this code, we have 3 threads to think about. We've got T1, T2, and the main thread. Plus, we also have the non-determinism of starting and stopping threads. So in this code, we do know a few things for sure, though. We know that the main thread is going to start before either of these other threads, but I don't actually begin the lifetime of this object inside a func called L in the main thread until line 24 is executed. But I still have that non-determinism of when will the threads themselves start. So we don't really know when T1 is going to start. We don't really know when T2 is going to start. But since they are J threads, we know that T2 is going to have its lifetime end before T1, and then we know T1 is going to have its lifetime end, and then we know that the main thread is going to have its lifetime end. And so we don't really have the determinism for when main, T1, and T2 are printed. Okay, I've just spent far too much time playing with this, and I think I've effectively shown the non-determinism of it. I've got this thing called multi-call, which is calling the function func multiple times per thread call. So then I've got T1, T2, T3, and T4, and I've got main calling the same function 4 times as well. So the first time you call func from a given thread, it begins the lifetime of this lifetime object and it prints its name. So it prints main, it prints T1, it prints T3, it prints T4, it prints T2. As you can see, highly non-deterministic. We don't know what order these things are going to occur in. And then it prints out the thread ID of the currently executing thread for each call to this func. So you'll see that the name is only printed once because the lifetime begins the first time this function is called from a given thread. And then it prints the thread ID. So we have the name main and the name T1. And then we've got the same thread ID 4 times, which tells us this is main. So main's thread has been executed 4 times all the way through, in between the time that T1 started up and printed its name and then printed its thread ID 3 times. And then when it's done executing, it destroys that thread local object when that thread's lifetime ends. And then similarly for T3 and T4, we can see that their lifetimes get interwoven here as well. And then T2 has its lifetime begin, prints its things out, and is destroyed. T4's threads don't seem to actually execute until last. All right, so threading is inherently non-deterministic. Threadlocal, that is threadlocal. And hopefully this episode ended up making some sense. I'm 28 minutes into recording right now, and I'm pretty sure this will get edited down into about 10 minutes. So hopefully it turns out into a good episode. Thank you for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. Be sure to subscribe and be sure to hire me for on-site training.